Jananim Saradam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagatgurum Pada Padme Tayo Shritva Pranamami Mohur Mohum. I welcome all of you to this new series of talks which we will be organizing every Tuesday. Tuesday is supposed to be, in the Indian tradition, a day when we worship Shakti, the feminine aspect of God. So Sri Ramakrishna, while he was in Dakshineshwar, very often used to say his Tuesday is a day of the Divine Mother. So every week of the day is dedicated to some major deity in Hinduism. For example, Somvar or Monday is supposed to be the day when Shiva is worshipped. And in the Ramakrishna tradition, Wednesday, because that was the day when Sri Ramakrishna was born, on Wednesday in 1836. So we consider Wednesday to be auspicious. So there are many, you can say that they are unwritten dates, but they are followed more or less by a large number of people in India. They believe that that particular aspect of a particular deity, certain aspects of that particular deity are more active during those days. It may just be a matter of faith, but then faith is very important in one's spiritual life. So as we know, doubt is like a demon which comes or arises from our ignorance, and or rather we can say false knowledge. When we say that we are doubting a certain thing, we don't have a knowledge of that thing and we keep doubting. Just as in the New Testament, we have this word doubting Thomas, because he doubted the very resurrection of Christ even after hearing from other disciples that they had seen Christ. After crucifixion, they had seen Christ. But people like Thomas, doubting Thomas, that's why this adjective has stuck to Thomas, because he doubted the resurrection, said, how is it possible? So there are many spiritual truths where faith plays an important part. But doubt can be a horrible demon, samshaya rakshasa. One of the famous hymns dedicated to Sri Ramakrishna, composed by Swami Vivekananda himself, he says, Sri Ramakrishna came to destroy the demon of doubt. Samshaya Rakshasa, Nasha Mahastram. He is the great weapon with which you can destroy the demon of doubt. So what do you mean by demon of doubt? He came to destroy the demon of doubt that spiritual realities or spiritual truths are something very tangible and can be acquired if we try hard. So that is what our Swami Vivekananda believed, that there are many kinds of doubts. There is doubt in the validity of scientific truths which had to be resolved or which had to be removed by experimental verification or proof. That's how scientific doubts are dispelled. And then when you show that certain occurrences or certain effects are definitely produced, because if certain conditions and causes are fulfilled, you give rise to certain effects or certain results. And when you prove it again and again and show that it is experimentally verified, then you say you don't doubt that theory. It is not a mere postulate or a hypothesis or a theory, but it is a practical verification of scientific truths. When I say scientific truths, it can be physical, it can be subtle. There are so many truths. Everything is scientific. Anything which follows this process of proposition, or maybe you postulate certain things, then you try to experimentally verify it, repeat the experiment, and then under the same conditions, it should be repeatedly verifiable by everybody. Universally, it should be universally and repeatedly, it should be verifiable by everyone and under in any part of the world. So then you say it, there is a scientific proof and you swear by science. So there are certain spiritual experiments in the spiritual field which have been similarly experientially through experiments, it has been verified. But then those experiments have to be done in the laboratory of spirituality. And that is the way these great spiritual scientists or prophets or the great avatars, these great people, they experimentally verify the truths that the scriptures propose. Scriptures are nothing but books. So that is why Vedantic religion, they never took verbal authority or scriptures as the ultimate proof. These scriptures have value if it is verifiable in the lives of people who follow a strict discipline and fulfill the conditions because of which by the agency of which you verify those spiritual truths. So when the Upanishad speaks about consciousness, about the realization of the supreme consciousness, which can be termed as Sat, Chit and Ananda, the eternal existence, which cannot be destroyed, which is eternal in nature. When they say that there is this unified consciousness, which unites all the so-called individual consciousness, which is a result of the ego, the smaller consciousness with which we associate our personality, those dissolve in the supreme consciousness. And unless one really dissolves one's individual consciousness in that supreme consciousness, then one cannot say that he has experimentally verified the scientific or scriptural truths. So every scientific or scriptural truth has to be verified in the laboratory where the conditions for attaining them are specified by those sciences. It can be a physical science. You can't apply the rules of physics to chemistry or some other science or biology. They have their own rules. Each science has its own rules, the conditions under which certain truths can be verified. And when they are universally verified, we call them laws. We call them scientific laws. And till they are proved to be wrong, they hold good. There are certain conditions. Scientists go on to develop newer laws, and then they establish better and newer laws as they change the circumstances. What is valid, the Newton's law, which are valid in a macro universe, when you go to the micro universe, when you go to the atomic level, you find that these laws are no longer valid. There are certain laws in that quantum world which has been studied in a subject known as quantum physics. So when you come to quantum physics, you apply different laws because the situations have changed, the magnitude of the things or the objects that you are studying have changed. So for different magnitudes under different conditions and increasing level of subtlety, more subtle things require more sophisticated instruments and a more sophisticated experimental procedures to verify them. So that's why you find that just as you demonstrate certain gross truths in your ordinary laboratory in schools, like the Newton's laws, you can't demonstrate those unless you have in the quantum world, unless you have certain sophisticated gadgets like electron microscopes and so many other devices which have been developed over a period of time, using various scientific technologies, using technological advances. We have developed certain instruments which can detect finer and finer things, more subtler things. So the yogis, the Patanjali's yoga and the yoga system, they all different paths of yoga, whether you follow the path of emotion, you follow the path of work, you follow the path of thinking, or willing, you use your willpower to do certain actions. Anything that is done in a particular way, which has been termed as yoga, enables your limited consciousness, which gives rise to all sorts of struggles, a sense of struggle, all sorts of problems, all sorts of different ailments, physical and mental, so many things trouble us. We want a solution. We want an ultimate solution to all those problems. And then when we struggle at a grosser level, we find the solution is always available at a slightly higher level or a slightly subtle level. The more subtle we go, the more permanent is the solution. That has been observed even in science. So when you are sick, maybe there are certain gross ways in which you can control that sickness. But if you go a bit deeper and have some kind of injections or tablets which attack, go to the root cause and try to control the disease from within, then you say it is a subtle method to solve your gross problems like pain, painkillers and fevers and other things we treat. But to treat the gross, we have to resort to more subtler methods of treatment. And the rule is that a gross problem can be solved at the gross level, at the material level, but it is a limited solution. It is a mere patchwork. You can maybe, if there is an infection, you can stop the pain by just using some hot water fermentation and other things. But if you want to solve it, you have to remove the root infection which is causing the pain. You have to go at the root of the problem and solve it. That is what medicine claims to do. So they use subtle ways and methods, and using the subtle ways and methods, they solve our gross problems. So spirituality also, all our mental worries, anxieties, many of them are gross. They are connected to our material existence. We miss certain gross things. We miss certain luxuries because we have been addicted to them. We miss many things in life because we have very strong likes and dislikes. And we miss those things if we don't get them. Or sometimes we don't want them and we get certain things which we dislike and we want to get rid of them. We want to get rid of pain. We want to get rid of depression. There are so many mental states in which we would not like to put ourselves in. So when we try to remove those problems, you find that the gross solution at the most temporarily stops it, temporarily helps us to solve that problem, but the problem recurs. So you go to a more subtler level to solve your mental problem. Go to the root, and then there is psychoanalysis, and so many psychological methods are there. When drugs do not work, there are certain other subtle methods with which the psychologists claim that they can get rid of the different complexes and the different complexes with which a personality is struggling. So we find that there are subtler and subtler ways of solving these problems in the mental sphere, in the mental aspect of our personality. So also when you come to the idea of the spirit, because as you all know, Vedanta believes that it is the spirit, all the religions, in fact, any true religion, which has the spiritual basis of every religion, believes that the spirit is supreme, and it is the spirit which gives us, connecting with that universal spirit gives us universal life. That is why people like Jesus, Buddha and all, they did not care to solve the problems of the gross world in a piecemeal way. They said that eternally you will be going on solving one problem after another. But to remove this, all these sorrows, which is known as Dukkha Harana, the removal of Dukkha, which is one of the primary motives or primary reasons why sadhana is done in Buddhist tradition, to remove of sorrow, all to remove gross sorrow, to remove subtle sorrows, all types of sorrows which result due to ignorance and false knowledge, that destroys our happiness and peace of mind. eternal happiness. It might give us temporary joy, but eternally it makes us more and more discontent. So, but how does faith come in? How does doubt or faith come in this? Holy Mother Sri Sarada Devi, whose biography we will be discussing on every Tuesday, was a woman who said one very important, there's a very important saying of hers. Once one young disciple, a woman disciple, because most of the people who came to the Holy Mother, especially during the initial days, they were all women. She was always surrounded by women because it was not very common in those days, in those orthodox days of Sri Ramakrishna and earlier in India, for men to come so often. Though she had a lot of male disciples, but it was primarily women who came with all their problems, with their domestic problems, because they had nowhere to go and they used to come. So she once told a disciple of hers who was suffering from certain inferiority complexes. As usual, the feminine gender, gender disparity, which we say we don't have now, but it is there right from time immemorial in most of the countries. Only in the Vedic age, they say, there was an attempt made to remove any disparity which was there between the genders. So women and men had equal right. But in this age, this particular age, as we discussed in our previous class, Holy Mother Sri Sarada Devi, whose biography we will be discussing, came to remove this inequalities because of gender. There were many other inequalities like race, caste, creed, ethnicity, and religion, especially religious wars were being fought. So Sri Ramakrishna solved gave solutions to many of the problems through his own life and message, through experiential verification of the truths. But it was left for Holy Mother to demonstrate what true motherhood of God is. So these young women who used to come, some of them were widows, and widows were not treated. They were not allowed to remarry, nor were they allowed to do anything independently. They lived a life of dependence. And in most of the cases, in most of the countries and cultures, you will find it is only recently that women have got social, socio-economic and political freedom. They can do, they can vote. Even till recently, women were not allowed to vote in a so-called advanced country like Europe and England. It was, women were given voting rights. Even in America, they had to struggle and fight for voting rights, because there was a feeling that women cannot take decisions, cannot administer, or cannot do things which normally is the prerogative of men alone. But that was wrong. That was proved wrong. And for one of the primary reasons of the incarnation of Holy Mother, Sri Sarada Devi, whose life we will discuss, was to re-establish the glory of a woman, the glory of a mother, the motherhood of God. More primarily, it was the motherhood of God that she came to demonstrate and to show what true empowerment is for a woman. So women's empowerment comes from certain qualities which we can find in the life of Holy Mother. So she told this young woman who came with some unique problem of her own, which was so common in those days. So she said, "My dear daughter, one should be faithful, or faith and firmness. Faith and firmness." Now, let us analyze this sentence. Faith and firmness is everything. If you have these two qualities, you can surmount all difficulties. What did she mean by faith? Faith means it is the removal of doubt, which is due to ignorance and false knowledge, that we think ourselves as limited human beings, restricted by our own ego, by our personality, which will always be limited when we are in the gross. But when we connect ourselves to the spirit, that is what yoga aims to do. Yoga aims to connect you to the infinite spirit within. And as spiritual people, you are immediately connected to the source of creation, and you become one with the Supreme Consciousness. So all your limiting adjuncts, which make you look, appear limited, they vanish. Because of ignorance of this unity with God, which is the goal of yoga, as I said. Yoga means to unite the individual consciousness with the Supreme Consciousness. So the whole of spirituality is a journey of the individual spirit, the individual soul, to find its identity with the universal soul. And the sooner you do it, whether you are a man or a woman, it doesn't matter which gender you belong to. Gender and other things give rise to diversity only at the gross level. But at the level of the mind, you can't distinguish between the mind of a woman and or a man. So Holy Mother suggested a universal solution, that do you have faith and do you have firmness? Now, what does this faith mean here? Faith is something which destroys our ignorance. It is not just belief. One has to remember, when she used faith, she used it. There is a Sanskrit word which she used, that is Shraddha. So Shraddha means it is something, it has an element of conviction in that, a conviction based on experience. So you can have faith that the milk is white because your mother has told you, but you have not seen milk. Say, for example, you have not seen the ocean, and you live in a countryside where you have never seen the ocean, you have tasted only fresh water. But somebody comes from the coastal area, your mother comes and says, you have not visited the sea, but the water is salty. So you will wonder, how can the water be salty? Because the water I taste here. So in the beginning, you need some kind of faith, but that is not some kind of belief. You have to believe somebody. You have to believe your mother when she says that, no, the sea water is salty. But when that conviction comes, when you go and really go to the beach, go to the seashore and taste the water there, and then you really come to the conclusion by virtue of the conviction that you have gained through experience that the water of the sea is salty. So that is how we establish Shraddha. So Shraddha doesn't come so quickly. Shraddha is something which is loosely translated as faith in the English language, but it is a limited meaning of that word. Faith is a limited meaning of the word Shraddha. Really, it means a belief or faith based on conviction. When that conviction is there, then that real Shraddha comes. And that is what Holy Mother meant, that if you have the real conviction, if you have the conviction that you are the spirit, that you are one with God, whether you believe in a personal God, whether you believe in Allah, whether you believe in the Father in heaven, or whether you believe in the Divine Mother, it doesn't really matter. As long as you consider that reality to be supreme and you connect yourself to that and you have faith in that, faith in the sense you have a faith because you have had some experience which shows that this connection helps you in your day-to-day life. Unless you have that conviction, then you may say, I have faith in God, I am a God-fearing person, I visit the temple, I visit the Bible, I visit the church, I read the Bible, and all those things you may say. But you still are at the level of belief. You just believe what is written in the Bible. You just believe what is written in the Gita. You believe in certain scriptures, which are nothing but words unless you realize them. But faith comes when you experience what is written in the Bible, you experience what is written in the Upanishads, you experience what is written in the scriptures, because they are spiritual truths which cannot be otherwise known unless somebody demonstrates it to you. Just as a scientist will not get a qualification in quantum physics unless he goes to a college which teaches him quantum physics, which takes him to the laboratory and shows all the experiments and does experimental verification of all the hypotheses he has studied in the books. Only when he does that, his knowledge of that particular science is complete. So also in spirituality, the spiritual truths have to be realized. So when Holy Mother said faith, she meant this Shraddha, which is born out of conviction. And that conviction comes only through effort. through some kind of practice, some kind of repeated practice. So happiness of mind or peace of mind and bliss and all those things, though they are very good to hear, but they are not achievable unless one removes the ignorance and false knowledge. What is obstructing our happiness? It's our limited knowledge, our limited faith or belief that we can't do this, we can't do that. So the more your faith is, the more your will develops, the more your ignorance goes away, the more empowered you feel. That is what Holy Mother said, that if you, my dear daughter, if you want to empower yourself, first have faith. First have faith in yourself. To put it in Swamiji's words, he said, you can't have faith in God if you don't have faith in yourself. If you don't have faith in your ability to realize the highest, to touch the highest, to connect yourself with the highest consciousness, then you can't have faith in God. Just saying, I have faith in God and I believe in God is a different thing than having total faith or Shraddha in God. So, true knowledge can uproot doubt. So, doubt or lack of faith is known as Sanshaya in Sanskrit. So, Sri Ramakrishna has been described as Sanshaya Rakshasa Nasha Mahastram. He is the weapon, Sri Ramakrishna, especially in the field of spirituality. He was the one who re-established spiritual truths to a skeptical mind who swore by science but criticized everything that was religious or spiritual. So spirituality, if it is based on certain dogmas or certain hypotheses or theories or some scriptures, just scriptures alone, without experimental verification, then the doubt will not go. You may read any amount of scriptures, you may go to any amount, listen to any amount of sermons, but you can't take anything on face value just because it has been spoken. The spoken word has power, has a lot of utility in taking us towards that goal, but it is not sufficient. One has to have experienced that truth. So, similarly, when we approach the life of Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi, who was the spiritual consort of Sri Ramakrishna, if you see Sri Ramakrishna's life, because you know he was quite older than Sri Ma Sharda Devi and she outlived him. She lived for nearly 34 years after his passing away. So there was a devotee. There is a wonderful incident which happened in the life of one devotee of Sri Ramakrishna who was a witness to the great Leela of Sri Ramakrishna, his great wonderful states. You see, it was a matter of experience. Skeptics came, scientists came, people belonging to different religions came and saw Sri Ramakrishna demonstrating the truths of spirituality as a scientist would demonstrate his experiments in the physical laboratory. Sri Ramakrishna demonstrated in Dakshineshwar and a lot of people belonging to different creeds, different religions, different sects within Hinduism and outside of Hinduism, they came and he managed to re-establish. So that's why there is a famous hymn, Sarva Dharma Sthapakastvam. You have re-established. You did not found a new religion because the world was teeming with so many religions. There were already so many religions and religious sects. And to add to the confusion, there were sects within these sects. And then there are so many denominations under each religion. Hinduism has so many. There are so many faiths. So also as Christianity and Islam, everybody starts a new denomination because based on his faith, because of some of the experiences that they experience, which may not be the highest experience, but they claim that they understand the prophet or the founder of their religion better or the scriptures of their religion better. And they feel that is the only path. Sri Ramakrishna agreed with all of them, said, as long as you get experientially verify what you claim to be the truth, it is fine for you, but don't say that is the only truth. It is just like saying a physics professor goes and says that I don't believe in what biology says. It cannot be true. What is true in the biological field may not be true in the physics. Physics may operate under certain different laws. Biology may operate under certain different laws. You cannot compare physics and biology. So also you cannot compare these religious paths. So when we come to the life of Holy Mother, we have to assume an attitude as we would do when we approach a certain scriptures. We have to approach a scientific approach. We have to adopt a scientific approach to understand the life and message of Srimad Sharada Devi. It is not that we have gathered here to discuss only a few incidents from her life. A lot of biographies are written where you have to evaluate or you have to remove your doubts regarding that the divinity of that personality by believing in certain incidents or certain those may have value. You see, the so many biblical incidents are there, so many miracles were performed, but then you have to tally it with the message they gave. So most of these prophets are personifications of the message or the certain qualities they said lead to true spirituality. So when you see compare most of these prophets, you cannot compare them. There are certain eternal values which are common. Otherwise, each path is different. The method of the experimental means are different, but the goal is the same. For example, everybody says truth is the goal of life. Truth or the eternal existence, nobody denies. Whether you believe in any physical sciences or material sciences or psychological sciences, you will find that there are certain things which everybody agrees to. One is experimental verification of what you claim to be the truth. And then it should be repeatedly verified, not just by once in one person. And then you say, I verified it, but you can't verify it. That should not be. It should be universally verified by everybody. So these spiritual truths, when Buddha said, I attained nirvana or attained to a state which he termed as Bodhi, that supreme consciousness, he did not claim that he was a unique person, who had the prerogative to reach this goal, whereas others had to just believe in him. No, he didn't say it. In fact, he did not found a religion in his own name. He just said, this is the truth, this is what I found, and you do the same experiments and you will see that you will also get the same realization. So when we approach any biography, we have to do some kind of experimental verification based on the incidents of their life. And this book, Sri Sharada Devi and Her Divine Play, is meant to confirm the divinity. Because as a spiritual consort of Sri Ramakrishna, and if we believe Sri Ramakrishna's wonderful belief, or we have faith in Shraddha in Sri Ramakrishna's life and message, then it cannot be that his spiritual consort, whom he respected so much, will not have those same qualities. In fact, there is a wonderful incident. We begin with that. One devotee from Kalma, that is now in Bangladesh, it's part of Bangladesh, but it was a part of the United India. He doubted, because when he saw Holy Mother Sarada Devi after the passing of Sri Ramakrishna, he doubted because he saw that Sri Ramakrishna was full of ecstasy and he had so many divine visions. He used to go into Samadhi, which many of the scientists there could not believe that such a state could be reached. Yoga claims that such states are there, but nobody had seen with their own eyes and been seeing these great truths being demonstrated. So naturally he felt Holy Mother Sri Ma Sharada Devi never developed or demonstrated these things in a very tangible way. Though those who were very close to her could witness certain states, Yoganandji and others, many of the disciples who belonged to the inner circle of Srima Sharada Devi were witness to these states, but she normally kept herself hidden. At least as long as Sri Ramakrishna was alive, as we discussed in our previous class, that we can divide our life into three phases. The first life was till Sri Ramakrishna passed away, 1886. So till then, from 1853 when she was born to 1886 when she finally, she came for the last few years, she was with the master for a long time in Dakshineshwar with Sri Ramakrishna. But that was the period when she kept herself hidden. Most of the devotees who came, they were either directed to Sri Ramakrishna or there were other people. But it was, Holy Mother was rarely exposed to these devotees. Only those who helped her in cooking food for Sri Ramakrishna, in all the various household duties, the big responsibility she had to face to feed so many people who used to come there and do certain errands for her. Only they knew who Holy Mother was. Otherwise, for the general public, they had never even, many of the devotees of Sri Ramakrishna had not even seen. So naturally, this devotee who used to come regularly from Bangladesh, from Kalma to visit the master, it was in his mind, there was a lot of uncertainty, like the doubting Thomas who doubted the divinity of Christ. This Kalma devotee, devotee from Kalma, thought that it is okay. Sri Ramakrishna was a divine person, a prophet or an avatara, I accept. But I can't say the same thing about the Holy Mother. She is one who is quietly cooking food. For several years, she was doing only that. Cooking, cleaning, and serving the devotees as well as Sri Ramakrishna. Even that was denied to her. But he says, Sri Ramakrishna may be an avatara, but Holy Mother has nothing to do. There is no divine, you cannot even compare her with Divine Mother. She just seems to be an ordinary person. And he expressed this doubt to the biographer of Sri Ramakrishna, the great master, Swami Sharadananda. Then he quietly replied to him, because he was an old devotee, believed in the master. He says, well, if you believe in the master, that he was an avatara, then why do you have such silly doubts about Holy Mother? Then that gentleman, that devotee said, well, the master had samadhi frequently, whereas I don't see any such state in the life of Holy Mother. So he humbly said, we saw Sri Ramakrishna performed a lot of sadhana, a lot of yoga, used to go in Panchavati and do very strenuous spiritual practices, but we don't see anything. Holy Mother, apparently nobody has seen her, what she did. Though she did lot of more than 100,000 japa, or the repeating of the holy name, and she used to get up early at 3 o'clock or even earlier, go and take a bath in the Ganges and quietly come and sit for meditation for hours together. And her whole day was spent in repeating the holy name. But that was not known to these people. So he said, we did not see Holy Mother in the state of samadhi or giving talks or discourses like Ramakrishna used to do, meet people, dance, go into ecstasy. We don't see anything, but we don't witness all these things in the Holy Mother. Moreover, she did not appear to have practiced sadhana, intense sadhana, or intense spiritual practices as the master did. Then Swami Sharadananda, very tactfully, like a lawyer would do, said, then you are not convinced that the master was God. But the devotee says, no, Swami, I wholeheartedly believe that the master, that Sri Ramakrishna was God himself, was an Ishwara, incarnation of divinity. Then Sharadananda responded, then do you believe that an avatara will marry a daughter of a poor woman who made her living by collecting and selling cow dung patties? That is what most of the women used to do. Poor women of the village, they used to make bricks out of the cow dung. They used to dry it. They were very good. They were used as fuel in most of the cooking that was done. The cow dung is a very good fuel, because once you dry it and make it into cakes, because there was not much of wood available to create a firewood and cook food. So this cow dung was used. That was a great recycling that these people did. So he said, so most of the poor women of the village, they used to, because nobody would do this kind of thing. How do you collect cow dung and dry it? It is such a dirty thing to do. But still, because it fetched some money, many people earned a living, especially in the villages. And they made their living by selling these cow dung cakes. And that was an extra source of income for their poor families. So Sarvasthananda said, do you think he will marry a cow dung, a woman who made her living collecting and selling cow dung cakes? So without saying any further, the devotee bowed down to Sarvasthananda and then he said, oh, thank you, my doubt is gone. So what Swami Sarvasthananda meant was that how can you have faith in Sri Ramakrishna and not have faith in Ma Sharada Devi? Because her life was not only connected, not only was she a spiritual consort of Sri Ramakrishna, but she was one whom Sri Ramakrishna worshipped when she was hardly 16 or 17. She was literally worshipped as the Divine Mother, which is unparalleled in the history of the world, a person worshipping his own wife. So Sri Ramakrishna was well known in those days also that he accepted all religions, religious traditions of different religions as true. And he was a truly spiritual phenomena. But the fact that the main intention or the main reason why he incarnated was to raise the glory of womanhood to a very high pedestal. And that he did symbolically by worshipping his own wife as the Divine Mother to show how much respect he gave to womankind. There cannot be a greater respect than you worshipping your own spiritual consort. And not only that, after that, before his passing away, he said, I have done whatever I could do, but you have to do a lot more. So Holy Mother, as usual, as you know, most of the women would say, were overly dependent on their husbands. She said, what can I do? I'm a mere woman. That was the psychology in those days. And it is there even today. Women feel that they are less empowered than men, especially when it comes to spiritual life. In secular and social life, there is a sort of parity, some kind of parity has been removed, or maybe there is some kind of equality because people are now taking up jobs which men normally did. All sorts of jobs women are doing. They are even entering politics and becoming prime ministers, and they are into administration. They are into almost every secular field. So that that inequality has been removed. But spiritually, even today, it would be very difficult to imagine an independent order founded by women and run by women, exclusively by women. Normally, most of the big churches and the big denominations of the different churches, you'll rarely find a woman as the head. So, Sri Ramakrishna, who came to establish a harmony of religions, at the same time, he came for another major mission, and that was to re-establish the true identity of the divinity of a woman and show to the world that a woman is as capable as a man to realize, not only to realize the truths within herself, for herself, but also be a spiritual instructor or a guru or a teacher, spiritual teacher in her own right. So that was what Sri Ramakrishna wanted to show through the life and message of Sri Ma Sharada Devi. And his wife, he himself, in the Hindu terminology, a wife, a spiritual consort especially, or is known as Sahadharmini. It's not in the context of a biological relationship as husband and wife, that is there. But this Sahadharmini means one who is an accompaniment to a man in all the aspects of spiritual life. Dharma means not just social dharma or economic field. She is a representative in the highest spiritual field also, and she is independent. So she, the word Sahadharmini can be translated as a co-partner of her husband in spiritual pursuits. So marriage definitely does not imply the superiority of the husband or the inferiority of the wife. That is what he came to remove. But the idea in the Vedic age especially, but slowly over a period of time, the idea of equality, the concept of Sahadharmini was diluted, partly because of certain religious sects which believed in the superiority of men. We do not have to name those religions. They came to India from outside, and most of those religious ideas or the religious beliefs or the religious ideas that they propagated relegated women to a inferior level. And they believed that, at least in the field of spirituality, one cannot be a spiritual teacher if one is a woman. She has always, even if she takes up to spiritual practices, she has to be subservient to the male. So you cannot expect the head of a religious order to be anybody other than a man. And leave alone having an order which is exclusively for women, which was started for the first time according to the instructions of Swami Vivekananda. The order for women, which was headed by a woman, which was run by women, and which comprised of women only. So that was the first monastic order totally independent of any interference by the other gender. I mean, there was no male interference. Even today, the order is totally independent. So this idea of Sahadharmini means the co-partner of a husband who is following spiritual pursuit. Sri Ramakrishna was definitely a divine personality in his own right, an avatara or divine incarnation. So they don't come alone. They come with their female counterpart, which is known as Shakti. So in the Hindu mythology, we have Shiva and Shakti, Vishnu and his Lakshmi, or the divine power associated with that. Ram came with Sita. So you see, the Sita is the, in Ramayana, if you see, she is the spiritual counterpart of Ramchandra, not just a biological wife. Then Krishna came with Radha, though Radha was not his spiritual wife. She was a divine power in her own right. And in fact, if you go to Vrindavan and some holy places associated with Krishna, they give more importance to Radha, because they feel that without Shakti, Shiva cannot be realized, or without Radha. That's why they always name her first. This tradition is unique in India. We always say Radha Krishna. We do not say Krishna Radha. Radha Krishna or Sita Ram, we don't say Ram Sita, Sita Ram. Always women have been placed at an exalted level in India. And then Buddha came with his wife Yashodhara, and Chaitanya came with his wife Vishnupriya. But none of the women who came with these incarnations, like Sita, Radha, Buddha, that Yashodhara and Vishnupriya with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all these women, they did not outlive, or they did not perform or survive the incarnation and carry on his message for 34 years as Srimad Sharada Devi did. You will find in the life of Buddha, Buddha lived to a ripe old age, and the contribution of his wife Yashodhara, though she joined the monastery and she became a nun, but her contribution is not so well known. So also Vishnupriya, practically unknown. Radha, of course, Radha and Sita are women personalities in their own right. They were great. Sita, especially Sita. But you won't, but in this incarnation, Sri Ramakrishna ensured that her role was more prominent than the male counterpart. So whenever an incarnation or a prophet or a great leader comes, about the other incarnations, of course, they did not have spiritual consort. So we cannot discuss those things. But wherever in Hinduism, at least, when you find an incarnation coming, he comes with a sahadharmini or a co-partner of the husband in spiritual pursuits. So Vedic age also, this idea of sahadharmini has its roots in the Vedas, where all the rituals, all the spiritual practices were performed, especially those were the days when lot of havanas and lot of sacred fires were lit and lot of mantras had to be chanted. That was the religious practice of those Vedic age. Lot of ritualistic sacrifices. So none of the sacrifices would be complete. A husband cannot do it alone. He has to do it. And they have to do chant the mantras together. So there is another concept which is very rare, which you won't find in any other religion. That is that of Ardhana or Ishvara. One side of the God, one side of the incarnation is man, the other side is woman. So what does it symbolize? That when a man desires or marries his wife and considers her as an object to satisfy physical desire, then disaster befalls the family. That is the concept. So this Ardhanarishvara, a Hindu scripture says in when they describe the Ardhanarishvara, that a woman can be a goddess of fortune for the righteous and a force of evil for the wicked. That is what the Chandi describes. So she can, if you take her, take a woman in the gross sense, then she can be destructive. That is what happens in the Chandi. The whole Chandi, if you see, people with evil intentions, the demons are replicas of the men who try to consider the women as just an object to satisfy physical desire. So for such, it is they are doomed. And that is what the Chandi gives a very strong message, that unless you look upon a woman as a divine mother, as a goddess of fortune, she can be a goddess of fortune, she can be Lakshmi, she can be Durga. But at the same time, if you treat her and in a gross way, and reduce her to a physical object, then the force, she becomes the force of evil, and that force destroys that person. So Sri Ramakrishna, divine life, Sri Ma Sharada Devi's divine life, most of her life, the 34 years of spiritual ministry, is a very, very important phase of her life. She lived for little more than 50 years, but you will see that the majority, the 34 years, which is a major part of her life, it was a life of inspiration, where in her own way, she did it conjointly with her spiritual consort. Sri Ramakrishna had his own divine life, divine play, which he enacted, and he passed away in 86. But Holy Mother's life began, most as it were, her divine play began after Sri Ramakrishna passed away. And after that only, a lot of monks, devotees, innumerable devotees got the message of Sri Ramakrishna through her. And she was not only the inspiration behind the Ramakrishna order, but she was the force that sustained it in its initial period, because she lived for a very long time, even after the passing away of Swami Vivekananda in 1901, Swami Yogananda passed away. So many of the monks passed away much before her. So her life was a glowing example, not only for householder devotees, but mainly even for monks. How Vedanta can be lived in our daily life. So for the first time in the history of the world, a life was lived by a Sahadharmini, where she showed that she can be a glowing example of Vedanta in practice, not only to the householders or merely women. She was ideal not only for women, but also for men and for monks as well as nuns. And how to adjust, how to live, how to lead a life, commune with God while living an intensely busy life in the world. That is another unique feature which we will not find in Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna led a totally God-centered life. But Holy Mother was a living example of how Vedanta can be lived, where one can commune with God while living in this world, commune with God as well as living with all the responsibilities and problems one faces in the world. How to lead a life which was both active. On one side, she was intensely active. She practically worked, cooked, cleaned, did everything a housewife would do or a mother of the family would do. But at the same time, she was absolutely, as far as contemplative nature is concerned, I think she even far surpassed anybody else. She could be deeply spiritual, and that is what firmness means. That firmness which she exhibited. How through forbearance and forgiveness she maintained that stability of the mind. Such a calm equanimity, such wonderful equanimity, forbearance, to which love and compassion was added. Humility, self-service, detachment, devotion, whatever spiritual qualities one needs to practice spiritual life were demonstrated in her own life in the worst trying circumstances, lived in the world, not out of the world. Anybody can be live in peace and joy and detachment and devotion when one is living alone, living a separate life, but living in the midst of people. I'm not saying that she exhibited a sense of aloofness even when she was living with all these people. You felt that as if she has all the qualities of a nun or a monk who lives in a monastery, but at the same time with active life, he tries to combine some kind of contemplative nature in himself. So in mother's life also, though she was living in a household, later on, of course, when she lived in Udbodhan or the mother's house in Bagh Bazar, she demonstrated that to the monks that how one could lead a contemplative life and yet be active. And of course, Swami Sharadananji was there, who was not only inspired by her, but tried to depict her role in the life of the Sri Ramakrishna incarnation. Though he did not write a biography, obviously he could not write because she was alive. Nobody normally writes a biography when, and she, it was Holy Mother's, after the passing of Holy Mother, that the thought came that a biography of Holy Mother should be written, but it was not until 1953, that is almost 33 years after her passing away, though some small booklets were there, but the comprehensive biography was written in 1953 for the first time. 54 it was released. So till then, Swami Sharadananji and all the other monastic disciples received a lot of inspiration from her. And she, before we start her biography or start discussing the incidents of her life, we'll just have a word. We'll discuss one word about her last message which she gave to one of her woman disciples, who was very sad when she came to know that Holy Mother is not in very good health and she might enter into Mahasamadhi soon. So they were all worried and said, what will happen to us after you go? You have been so kind to us. You have been a guiding force for all of us. So then they wanted some parting advice from her, that lady, the woman disciple. So she was told, my child, if you want peace of mind, this is her last uttered words or the last message, you can say. The great message which every one of us have to remember. My child, if you want peace of mind, do not find fault with others. See your own faults. Learn to make the whole world your own. No one is a stranger, my child. The whole world is your own. She repeated it twice. So you see what a universal message she gave just before she left. She did not come for any particular culture, though she was born in Jairambati and a small rural area of rural setting of Bengal. But so many people, Nivedita and so many Western women came to her. And even today, a lot of them are finding solace. And they find that here is an ideal. as Sister Nivedita famously said, who said, is she the last of the ancient ideal of ancient order of women, great women, or is she the first in the new order of women? So she was a bit confused to judge the position of Holy Mother in history, whether she was the last. After that, you won't find women like her, or maybe she is the first, and taking her as an ideal, considering Holy Mother as an ideal, women would increasingly develop their life or around that ideal and grow grow in spirituality, and finally empower themselves in the true sense, as Sri Ramakrishna or Swamiji wanted women to be. So when he was asked questions about women's empowerment, even when Holy Mother was not so well known, Srima Sharda Devi, at least when Swamiji was alive, she was practically hidden. It was just after the passing of Sri Ramakrishna. So Swamiji did not live long, and he was traveling all over the world. So he hardly had a chance to speak. But to some people, especially some of his women disciples, he pointed out, gave some hints. And that those hints, Josephine McLeod, and there were so many other, Sister Christine, they all listened to their guru and came to India and saw the real women's empowerment was being enacted here in India, in a very corner of Calcutta or maybe corner of rural Bengal. A great women's empowerment movement was taking shape, and they were guided by her. Sister Nivedita herself admits they all considered the small group of women, both Western and Indian, gathered around Holy Mother and got a lot of inspiration, support, and spiritual guidance. And then they themselves spread that idea, the idea of women's empowerment, the idea of what true motherhood of God or motherhood of what true motherhood is there. Mother is an ideal for women that was established, and they took it forward. It was the Western women who had seen the other side of women's empowerment, the physical side of women's empowerment, because Sister Nivedita had a lot of friends, Miss Henrietta Muller, who did a lot. And in fact, she wanted, hoped that Swamiji would support her in her women's reform movement, the movement in which they struggled to they fight for their rights. But Swamiji said that there is a far bigger task left for me, that is the spiritual empowerment of women. I don't want to waste my time in these efforts, because there were a lot of efforts being taken, which were taking place in England, in America, and other Western countries, where women were trying to assert their rights, try to establish some kind of identity of their own, trying to empower themselves in the way they thought was perfect. But Swamiji came and pointed out to these Western women who were his disciples that you look at Mother Sharda Devi, if you go to India, especially told Nivedita, you will find in her an ideal which you can emulate and try to put before the world as an ideal for modern, not only for Indian women, but a modern ideal for the women of the entire world. So today we will conclude now before in our next Tuesday class, we'll try to take up her birth and many incidents about her childhood. Though the true women's empowerment you can find after the passing away of Sri Ramakrishna, but her life, even before that, if we just analyze, discuss the various incidents before she was born, after she was born, and as a child, Sarada, and there are so many wonderful incidents which gave an idea of the divinity that she would manifest in later life. So the first phase of her life will comprise of 9 chapters of this book. So the first 9 chapters will deal with the Adi Leela, the first phase of her life, where she underwent training under Sri Ramakrishna, being the spiritual consort, and she was much younger in age, as we saw. She was born in 1853. Sri Ramakrishna was born in 1836. So naturally, when she came to Sri Ramakrishna, she was a very small girl. And then in a later age, she came and stayed with Dakshineshwar, got all the training till 1886. And then the second phase and the third phase began, which we'll discuss later. So the first 9 chapters, which will take a lot of time, will be focused on her childhood days. And not only her childhood days, but her days of youth and how she came and how she was trained by Sri Ramakrishna and all that. So we will continue in the next class. And if there are some questions, I will, yeah. So there is a question which says that the fact that Sri Ma's life was domestic and culturally specific seems to mean that her mind was free to be contemplative and think on the highest truths. Many women today, taking her as a role model, may find a conflict because they are rarely exclusively domestic and in intellectually and professionally demanding jobs. This can create a feeling of distance from mother. No, I don't agree fully, because don't think that Holy Mother was lived her entire life in a domestic setting. The first phase of her life, it's okay. She lived in a village, quietly, not moving out of her house. But the second part, and especially the third part, I don't think even Sri Ramakrishna traveled as much as she did. She went to different places. She went to Chennai. She went to at the invitation of Shashi Maharaj. She went to Orissa. She stayed in different places, meeting different people, which even a modern executive woman would not do. And it was not only the domestic setting, especially the later part of her life. It was not just a domestic setting. In Udbodhan, if you see, for example, all topics, all important discussions, decisions about the Ramakrishna order, which had expanded to so many centers. She visited Haridwar, she visited so many places. No modern woman would be so active and so fearless and guiding so many men, especially great spiritual giants like Brahmananda, Sharadananda, even Swami Vivekananda. He never took a decision without consulting her. So it would be wrong to assume that she lived in a very quiet domestic setting and just cooked food. That is, that she did effortlessly, no doubt. She did it. She didn't consider it to be a thing which modern executive women perhaps find it beyond their dignity to cook food for their own people. But very interestingly, one of the women CEOs of Pepsi, whose mother happened to be a devotee of Holy Mother, I was inspired by Holy Mother Sharada Devi. And she had decided that throughout her life, throughout her career, as I read one of the interviews, the CEO of Pepsi, Indira Nui, who of course lived in America, but she was born and brought up in Chennai. So she said, my whole life, I have never allowed anybody, my own daughter, I have cooked food, done everything which a domestic housewife would do. So that domestic setting, because mother had lived in a domestic setting, doesn't mean that she had not. Of course, she did not have to do the role. Her role was different. She may not be a CEO of a company, commercial company like Pepsi. But it is possible to combine both these roles. And in Holy Mother's life, we find that it was no less than the CEO of a company, because she had to take momentous decisions when there were a lot of troubles which Ramakrishna mission had to face, because we were under the British rule. So there were a lot of restrictions. We were not free. Till 1947, we were not free. India was not a free country. So there were people, there were a lot of issues, social, economic, political, because a lot of philanthropic activities were being done in the spirit of serving God in man. So many hospitals, and Holy Mother visited. She visited Banaras, one of the oldest hospitals, which served poor patients worshipping them in the spirit of God. So she gave advice. There was so much of conflict there going on, whether monks should serve these patients or should they contemplate. And she gave decisions. So it is not that she was practically like the CEO of the entire Ramakrishna movement with so many centers, which even a man would find it difficult. So Holy Mother did not live a life of contemplation, just living like a domestic, in a domestic setting. She lived in a rural setting, no doubt, but also she used to now and then go to cities. She used to go to Calcutta. She went to many other places, which were definitely not rural areas in those days. They were the hotbeds of modern Western culture, especially Calcutta. So she lived in Calcutta for such a long time and met so many people, so many modern people, or even modern women, whatever little modernity people had imitated from the West, the Indian women. And then she met a lot of Western women, Jojo, and so many Western women went to her. And she guided all of them, including Sister Nivedita. So, yeah. So that is why it is possible for modern women as well. It's not that it's only possible for ancient women. That's why old Sister Nivedita said, was she the last of the old order? Because even she was surprised. How can a Holy Mother who belonged to a rural setting be so modern in her approach, asking widows to study in Nivedita school, which was unimaginable in those days, and take up to some kind of livelihood, earn money, stand on their own feet. All these things, they are more difficult than any CEO of a woman CEO could probably do. So professional life has the professional life which a modern woman has to adjust with, or maybe live, is nothing compared to the professional life. It's maybe the setting was not professional, but the task was as difficult as any professional woman working in a company or some institution. Yes. So somebody has written, only the busy modern women can do it. In fact, this multitasking is possible for both types of women, whether it is rural or a professional life led in a city. Yeah, I agree. So this is a good remark, because for them it is, they have been trained. They have the benefit of modern education, which Holy Mother wanted every girl who studied in Nivedita's school. She was very particular that they receive modern Western education, not Western, modern education, so that they develop their skills. They can earn their living if necessary, if they are independent. So she set an ideal for them, though she herself did not earn, but she wanted many of the students of Sister Nivedita, like Jagdish Chandra Bose's sister, they all took up professional jobs as teachers. In those days, you will find so many women took to earning money. Some of them came to England. In fact, many of them came to England and then studied law. And there are so many. One woman I'll mention in my next class was Ansuya bin Sarabhai, who was totally inspired by Swamiji and Holy Mother Sharda Devi, and who became a phenomenal woman leader in India, started one of the first trade unions for women. She was educated in England. She studied in London. She studied in London. She did her law, completed her law studies, went back. She was a contemporary of Gandhi. So Ansuya Ben was an ideal example of a woman who was born in an ancient tradition, married at the age of 12, left her husband, and developed a career of her own and served the women of India and started one of the biggest women's organization and administered it very successfully till the end of her life. So there are very many inspiring stories where this ideal, an ideal of a empowered woman, in spite of being a very, very busy professional, has been demonstrated before the world. Okay? So I'll take your leave. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.
Thank you, Mahar. Namaste.
Yeah, somebody has given a nice comment that even Sri Ramakrishna encouraged her to grow her own spinach patch in Jairambati. He said, don't depend on others. Be free from depending on others. Don't ask anybody for money. After his passing away, he knew that Holy Mother, if she doesn't manage to earn a living, she'll be in trouble. So he arranged for a small sum. But then she said, you grow some spinach when you stay in Kamarpukur, and whatever rice they got by cultivation, said, don't ask any help from anybody. Be independent, earn, cook your own food by whatever you grow in the field, effort. He encouraged that kind of independence even in those days, which was unimaginable to live for a woman to live alone, especially a widow to live alone, a young widow. She was very young when Sri Ramakrishna passed away. She after lived for 34 years. So practically, she used to feed so many people, so many relatives, and without asking anybody. Of course, some people used to come and help, but Thakur had told her never ask anything of it. He wanted her to be as independent as a modern woman would be, who would not like to depend on men.
Thank you, Mahar.